station on two for Jonny and Tak. We got good KU, so we're going to start the event here in just a few seconds. And Anne has graciously offered to do the HTV activities, so you can still hang out in the PAO event. Tak. Station, this is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
Houston Station, we are ready for the event.
Houston ACR, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Houston ACR. How do you hear me?
Houston Station, I have you loud and clear. How me?
Got you 5x5. Please stand by for opening remarks.
My name is Annika Jensen. I am the Executive Director of the Douglas Space and Science Foundation and their Star Camp programs in northern Utah. Through in-classroom field trips, community events, and the coolest summer camp on Earth, we welcome learners of all ages and abilities to thrive in an environment of belonging, curiosity, leadership, passion, and teamwork. Our questions today come from kids across the country who are inspired by all aspects of the space program. Here's our first question.
Hi. I'm Matthew, and my question is, what adjustments does your body need to make when you go to the International Space Station in order to live in space?
Hi, Matthew. Our bodies go through a lot. So the biggest difference about living in space is that there's no gravity. So living in microgravity, because we don't have that force weighing us down, a lot of the fluids in our body shifts, and this results in a lot of changes. Initially, our faces can look puffy, but also our bones and muscles can deteriorate, which is why we have to exercise and do various countermeasures to make sure we're healthy every single day.
My name is Savannah. What is the most exciting possibility coming in space exploration?
Hi, I think going back to the moon and exploring its surface on a pressurized rover will be one of the most exciting things in the future. Thank you.
My name is Selena, and my question is, what hobbies, interests, and other things would I have to give up to be in your shoes?
Hi, Selena. So it does take a lot of hard work and sacrifice to become an astronaut, but you don't really have to give up your hobbies. The best way is to find your passion in life, something that you can do for work and pursue professionally, but also something you really, really love. And in a lot of ways, you can continue those hobbies. And up here, we do have some free time. So we have a guitar, we've got a keyboard, people like to read. You can maintain various hobbies in space.
My name is Erica. At Star Camp, we work in teams of 6 to 8 people. What are some of the things you do to build teamwork and get along as a crew on the station?
Hi, thank you for a great question. So we help each other a lot here on board the station. And when somebody has a problem, we face it as a team, and I believe going through some challenges together makes a team much stronger and much more united.
My name is Graham. My question is, have you ever had a tool break while you were using it on station? If so, what did you do to fix it?
So, you know, that's just a part of life on the space station. We are professional fix-it uppers. And so sometimes tools break. We always have a plan. Sometimes we have an alternate, or we can use a different tool. Or sometimes we have to be creative and use a workaround to get around that. So it's a great question.
My name is Rocky. My question is, what is the biggest misunderstanding about space people have?
Hi. People might think astronauts are traveling very far, but actually the International Space Station is flying at an altitude of 400 kilometers, It's about 260 miles. And it, compared to Earth's size, 400 kilometers is just like this. So actually, we are not traveling so far. Actually, instead, we are traveling very fast.
My name is Olivia. How is the International Space Station and the crew protected from debris in space?
Hey, Maria. So we have specialized outer hull structures that do protect us from micrometeoroids, but also a lot of major debris in space is tracked actively. And so if there's any kind of debris that might have a collision course with us, we are notified in advance. We can shelter in place, but also we can enable a thruster type of maneuver to either to increase our altitude or really change our altitude so that we're not in the same trajectory as that debris.
Hi, my name is Jimmy. How do you celebrate birthdays on the International Space Station? Can you use candles?
Hi, unfortunately, we cannot use candles or any other source of fire because those things are considered as a hazard. But instead, we do make a cake to celebrate our birthdays and also do have some group dinner together. So there are some couple of ways still for us to celebrate our birthday. Thank you.
My name is Jules. What is your favorite experiment you're working on during your current mission?
Hi, Jules. My most favorite experiment right now is called ring shear drop. And what it's doing is it's investigating how certain proteins crystallize in a microgravity environment. And that's important because it can improve the potency of drugs that we have back on home and help sick people.
My name is James. What are you currently working on that could help our climate on Earth?
Hi, we take a lot of pictures of Earth from here, this International Space Station. We have a very nice window. It's called the cupola. And our pictures are considered as Earth observation so that researchers on the ground use those pictures in order to understand what kind of changes are going on the ground and also climate changes.
My name is Haley. And I have amblyopia in my right eye, and I read that many astronauts develop vision problems in space. How do these conditions present as issues in space?
Hi, Haley. So because we don't have the force of gravity acting on our bodies, it causes a lot of fluid shifts. And sometimes those fluid shifts can go to our head. And we don't exactly know the real reason, but we think it causes a syndrome called space-associated neuroocular syndrome, which is a really fancy word. We just call it SANS for short. But SANS can result in astronauts having decreased vision acuity over really long duration space flight. So it's important that we figure this out and how to counteract it, especially if we're going to go to the moon and beyond.
I'm Alex. My question is, how does studying the structure of the eye in outer space help optometrists and ophthalmologists on Earth?
Hi, just like Jonny said, studying about how microgravity affects our eyes is very important because we think pressure increase in our brains affect the eyes' shape or vision. So that's why we are conducting various kinds of research about eyes on the International Space Station. And the same thing could happen even on the ground if for some reason internal pressure of the brain increases. And we hope specialists on the ground utilize our data in order to better understand those symptoms. Thank you.
My name is Gabe. Why do you need to use an X-ray telescope to see a neutron star?
It's a great question. So Neutron stars are these massive, massive stars with tons of energy. And when they eventually run out of fuel, they collapse under their own gravity. And what's emitted is a lot of energy that happens to be in the X-ray spectrum, which is something that we can't see with our eyes. And also on Earth, the atmosphere happens to absorb a lot of these waves. So here on the space station, without having that blanket of atmosphere, we have various instruments on the outside of the space station that can detect these.
Hi, my name is Zachary, and my question is, why is it so hard to grow plants in space?
Hi, we have been conducting a series of plant experiments. So far, we have grown lettuce, tomatoes, and so on. So I think we have learned many important things in order to grow plants here in microgravity in space. For example, how to provide water in microgravity and how to provide nutrition, and also lighting is also very important because on the ground, the plant use gravity in order to get to know where it should grow up. But here, since we don't have gravity, plants tend to use lighting in order to know what kind of direction they are going to grow. So those kind of knowledge will help us to grow many plants or vegetables in order to get ready for future further space exploration. Thank you for a great question.
My name is James. Did you get to choose your experiments or were they assigned to you?
So there's a lot of experiments going on at any given time, and we don't choose which experiments we do, but we can give our preferences on things that we're interested in. But we all take turns on the same experiment. So over a long period of time, each of us will have a contribution in all of these experiments on the space station.
My name is Jack. Is eating or swallowing food in space hard without gravity?
Yes, it is. Initially, I felt it was super difficult to swallow something like food. I feel something strange when I ate. I think that's because I needed to swallow consciously swallow when I eat something. But the good thing is our bodies can adapt to microgravity very well and very quickly. So now I don't have any issue with eating. I can eat without thinking anything. So that's good. Thank you.
My name is Marin, and my question is, where did the idea to experiment with microalgae proteins come from?
So microalgae are fascinating. They can produce a lot of proteins and amino acids that are really essential for human. And they take a lot less work, energy, sunlight to grow. And so the idea is if we can somehow harness microalgae's ability to produce those important nutrients in a really cost-effective way, then that might be a potentially great resource, especially for very, very long-duration space flights.
My name is Olive. I am super curious as to how you find any time to yourself in space. How do you escape for a little bit from the routine and interactions of work on the station?
Hi, we have regular weekends just like you do on the ground. And the ground team tries very hard to protect our private time, so which is good. And how to spend our free time is totally depends on the individuals. For my case, I love to listen to music, watch movies, and read books and emails to my friends, and also video chat with my families or friends. So we have many, many ways to spend our free time here.
My name is Angie. How do you learn to control the spacecraft that get you to the International Space Station?
through a lot of training. We have amazing instructors and equipment and facilities at NASA, and we train years before a space flight. Specifically, we learn to how to not just do nominal operations, but how to react in any kind of emergency type of situation, which sounds scary, but with a lot of training and studying, it all becomes, and a lot of great teamwork, it's very, very possible.
My name is Myra. How I watch is created in space.
Hi. That's a very interesting question. I never thought about it. And probably I don't know the answer, but I never also heard any kind specific watch doesn't work in microgravity. So maybe we don't need to do anything special. So I use a regular watch that I usually use on the ground, and it's totally working fine. So I don't know. Thank you for the question.
Hi, I'm Jack, and my question is, what is the coolest trick you can do in microgravity, and could you show us?
Hey, Jack, microgravity is really, really fun. One thing is just, it's fascinating to watch how liquids react in space, and I got a little coffee ball. I'm going to drink it before it gets somewhere. And one other thing is doing flips. Thanks, Jack.
Hi, my name is Chris, and I was wondering, how often do you guys get to look out of the observer station on the International Space Station?
Yeah, I would say very often, at least a couple of times in a day. Like I said, we have a very nice window module called Cupola, and some people really love to take pictures from that module. So that's definitely the one of the most popular modules on the International Space Station. So thank you for the question.
My name is Gavin. What was the main reason why you wanted to go to space?
Hi, Gavin. I think exploration and that quest for adventure is written in all of human DNA. And so I've always wanted to be a part of that. I've always wanted to be part of a great team doing challenging things. But probably the biggest reason is I think inspiration is very important, and so I wanted to have a contribution in inspiring the next generation to be the best versions of themselves for the betterment of the world.
My name is Samantha. What does the moon look like from where you are on the station?
Hi. The size of the moon is almost the same. However, since we don't have atmosphere in space, we can see the moon, I think, much more clearly, and it's very sharp from here. It's a great view. Thank you.
At Star Camp, we empower kids with the understanding that they can design their own futures through determination, goal setting, good study habits, pride in their accomplishments, and service to others. Thank you so much for this opportunity to connect our young space enthusiasts with role models who are a few years ahead of them in the climb toward their dreams.
Thank you for great questions. We really enjoyed talking with you guys. See you on the ground.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you to all participants. Station, we are now resuming operational audio communications.